generally, when I mention the name of this song cycle, people's first reactions are something along the lines of, what? I've never heard of that. Are you sure Schumann wrote that? After explaining that, yes, Schumann did compose this cycle, and yes, I did find it interesting, I watch as their eyes glaze over while I explain this until they completely lose interest and we move on. This lecture will hopefully not be that. When I designed the independent study that resulted in this paper, I had no idea what song cycle of Schumann's I would be analyzing. As I was sifting through the hundreds of pages I falsely assumed that I could read in 2 days, I found this injudicious quote from Jack Stein on the Wilhelmmeisterlieder. Quote, "There is no relation whatsoever between Schumann's songs and Goethe's novel. Not only would it be inconceivable for any of the novel's characters to produce such music for their poems, but even the atmosphere and mood of the songs are not related to the characters in any way," end quote. While thinking of what I knew about Schumann, something about this quote seemed wrong. This is not the only piece in which people assume Schumann has taken poetry out of context for the sake of his own art. If I found that certain aspects of this statement were wrong, I could maybe open up a new way of viewing the song cycle. So I developed the hypothesis that while it seemed that this song cycle was not related to Goethe's novel, perhaps there was a different link beyond the superficial one that could explain the disconnect. In order to prove this, I not only read books on Schumann and his song cycle, but I also read books and articles on Goethe himself, as well as a translation of Wilhelmmeister's Lehrgabe, so as to demonstrate how Schumann does not completely disregard the novel, but rather creatively interprets different aspects of the novel beyond the plot, specifically the theme of liminality. To illustrate this claim, I will first describe aspects of Schumann's history so as to understand why it seems impossible for Schumann to completely disregard an author in favor of his own music. Then I will discuss Goethe and his novel, specifically some of the thematic material which I believe Schumann was using to influence his composition. Finally, I will prove that Schumann interpreted this thematic material, namely liminality, and used it in his composition, thus proving that a different interpretation of Schumann's music is viable. I will mainly focus on the songs of Mignon's perspective, and I will interleave the discussion with my performance of the pieces themselves. First, in order to understand why Schumann may have used aspects of Goethe's novel, we must first understand his background. Robert Schumann, born June 8, 1810, was raised by August Schumann, a bookseller and publisher who believed that, quote, "what binds the Germans as a nation is their literature," end quote. Schumann had a similar passion in his youth, since he founded the Literarischer Verein with several other students in order to study literature. Schumann had a particular affinity for the author Jean-Paul, who was known for including music as triggers for epiphanies in his novels. Taruskin points out that one of Schumann's early pieces was based on a Bildungsroman written by Jean-Paul, creating precedents for my argument. Schumann's career is also marked by incredible amounts of writing for the Neue Zeitschrift für Musik, which also points to a passion for writing and reading. Many of these writings were not written from Schumann's perspective, but rather from that of fictional characters, which Schumann invented for this critical purpose. Taruskin also describes Schumann's music as being literary music, thus making Stein's claim unrealistic, and rather making it more plausible that Schumann would respect the literary traditions of authors he was interpreting. As a result, it becomes necessary for us to understand Schumann's music, as de Verio says, as being, quote, "imbued with the same intellectual substance as literature," end quote. Next, we turn to Goethe and his novel. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe was one of the most celebrated German authors of his time. The complex nature of his novels, along with the sheer volume of them, has put him on par with writers like Shakespeare and Dante. His novel, Wilhelmmeister's Lehrjahre, or Wilhelmmeister's Apprenticeship or Learning Year, to be more accurate, is considered one of the first and stereotypical Bildungsromane, or novel of education or formation. The word Bildung refers to education, but more importantly, all-around personal development. This concept is clearly connected to the title, since both involve education of some kind, though often this education goes beyond what a classroom can teach and refers to life lessons learned through specific experiences. As Suzanne Howe explains, Wilhelm Meister explores, quote, the idea that living is an art which may be learned, and that the young person passes through the stages of an apprenticeship in learning it, until at last he becomes a master, end quote. In order to understand the context of the songs, I will now describe the basic plot of the novel. It revolves around the story of Wilhelm, a young man in search of his role in society. Wilhelm's story is told by an unidentified narrator who has an intimate connection with both Wilhelm and the reader. In the beginning of the story, Wilhelm loves a young woman, Mariana, who also loves Wilhelm. However, he is not wealthy and doesn't have a respectable job. Although Wilhelm wishes to marry her, he also wishes to find his place in the world as an actor. When Wilhelm discovers that Mariana has another wealthier suitor, he leaves to join a traveling performance troupe. Through Wilhelm's adventures, other main characters, including the ones found in Schumann's song cycle, are introduced. Probably the most famous figure is that of Mignon, a young dancer whom Wilhelm buys for 100 ducats in order to save her from a previous master who treated her poorly. She is described as androgynous and wild, yet religious as she goes to mass every morning. Wilhelm treats her almost as a daughter and does his best to take care of her. We also meet the harper, a singer by trade, who is recruited into the troupe by Wilhelm because the harper's songs often reflect his own sorrows. Felina, a playful singer, is another member of the troupe and has an unrequited love for Wilhelm. Various events and philosophical discussions take place along Wilhelm's physical and emotional journey to self-discovery, and in the end, Wilhelm marries Natalie, another woman whom he meets on the road. Mignon, who was in love with Wilhelm, dies of heartbreak as a result. One of the main themes of this novel, and of the genre Bildungsroman in general, is that of liminality, which is defined as a point of transition at which the character is neither in the place they started nor in the place they end up. Liminality is found in several aspects of Goethe's novel, the most obvious of which is that of the traveling troupe, which doesn't have a single home and thus is constantly in liminal space. Another example is found in Wilhelm's career as an actor. This profession naturally lives in the transitory space between fiction and reality and is clearly related to Wilhelm's transitory state and is how he learns more about the profession and life more broadly. Mignon also represents the concept of liminality in two distinct ways. She is generally androgynous as she first refuses to wear female clothing. Additionally, she also represents transition between life and death, not only because she dies in the end, but also because she is described as ethereal. She appears to be not of this world, yet her body remains part of it. Liminality is also represented in how Wilhelm fits in with these characters. Many of them are lower class, whereas Wilhelm is from a higher class, since his father was a well-respected businessman. But the fact that he chooses to travel with them puts him in an odd or even uncomfortable place between the two classes. Eventually, he has to choose whether to return to his lifestyle in a higher class or to pursue his life as an actor and remain in the lower class. Finally, the narrator also acts as a liminal character. He has a relationship with both the reader and Wilhelm, since he not only addresses the reader directly in the novel, but also has intimate knowledge of Wilhelm's thoughts and feelings. Though the identity of the narrator is unknown, it is clear that he exists in the liminal space between fiction and reality. Other examples of liminality are found in the way the three-volume novel is organized. The novel itself is comprised of 8 smaller books, which are also divided into various chapters. While we understand chapters as contained within a single scene or setting, as in a play, here the novel scenes are broken up into several chapters. Often the scenes don't even change location, but arbitrarily cut to a new chapter. Moreover, there are occasional temporal shifts between chapters, or more often books, disconnecting the narrative from time. In our reality, scenes, or memories, are usually continuous when they appear in the same location. Here they are broken up, which not only physically breaks up the scene, but jolts the reader out of the novel, reminding them that the story is not reality. The genre of the novel also points to liminality because of how it crosses between other literary genres and such as poetry and drama. It is a novel by all means, but also has specific and lyrical descriptions of the songs, which have been set not only by Schumann, but also by many other composers. These descriptions are of the music itself, not merely how the character sounded while singing it or even what the character was doing while singing it, They are mostly described as songs rather than poems, which creates questions about whether they are meant to describe the scene or to create directions for composers and performers, almost as if Goethe was writing a play or even a libretto for an opera. Now that we've discussed the novel and the theme of liminality and how Schumann's connections to literary traditions preclude him from disregarding the work, I will now prove how he included this theme into his cycle. For this part of my presentation, I will first describe the song cycle as a whole and then the specific songs. After talking about each one, I will sing them so you can listen to the music with that information in mind. First, we must talk about the unique construction of the song cycle. A song cycle is generally a collection of short art songs, often with an overarching plot, sung by a single character. Wilhelm Meister transgresses this not only by having three characters, but also by interweaving their individual storylines, which are superimposed on the plot of the Wilhelm Meister books. In this way, the song cycle acts not as a stereotypical cycle, but rather exists in the liminal space between established genres. Another distinguishing feature is its quasi-dramatic nature, as a result of its connection to Schumann's Requiem for Mignon, Opus 98b, which is more on the side of oratorio, even though it is labeled as a requiem. Dramatic in this case refers to something more theatrical, like something performed on a stage. Schumann wanted both the Requiem and the Lieder to be published under a single opus title. However, due to the different instrumentation, the publisher compromised by separating the collection into two parts. The fact that both parts were intended to be a single piece rather than two, and yet are composed for widely different ensembles, is quite unusual. In this way, Schumann has removed both Opus 98a and 98b from typical genres, and instead creates a new, unidentified genre, which lies somewhere between a song cycle and a more dramatic work, like a requiem or other choral genre, thus linking it to liminality. John DeBerio explains this connection by saying that Schumann, quote, was a master of transforming one genre into another, without our being able to pinpoint where one leaves off and the other begins. Opus 98a compresses all of the elements of an operatic scena, instrumental introduction, recitative, and aria, into the smallest of spaces. The two works are therefore connected in terms of their relation to genre. This connection also suggests that Schumann interpreted Goethe's works in a similar way, namely that its genre was obscured, and worked that interpretation into how he constructed the opus. Schumann's interpretation of liminality in Goethe's novel can also be seen in the way the cycle itself is put together. By interspersing the character songs, each character is placed in a liminal space while the other character sings. This distorts reality since it breaks up the linear progression of each character's development throughout the song cycle, similar to how Goethe breaks up each scene into several chapters, despite the characters not changing locations or even conversations. On the screen, the order of the poems is found, first as they appear in Goethe's novel, and second as Schumann orders them. It is very clear that Schumann purposefully moved around all the songs, except for the last one, into a specific order. By organizing the songs in the way that he does, Schumann takes time and narrative out of the equation and instead focuses on the larger thematic material, as well as the role that the characters play in the novel. It can be concluded that Schumann observed the style in which Goethe wrote Wilhelm Meister and emulated a similar style in organizing the song cycle. I will now focus on the Lieder sung by Mignon, who is one of the most well-known of the three characters, to show how the music connects to liminality. As you will recall, Mignon represents a childlike, innocent love, as well as being an ethereal, androgynous presence. This is also seen in the Requiem for Mignon, where Mignon is cast, quote, not as an angelic sufferer, but as contemplative and knowing in mysterious ways, no martyr to be mourned, but herald of immortality in death, end quote. Mignon sings Kennst du das Land for Wilhelm and asks him to transcribe it. She was taken from Italy, which is her native homeland, but still longs to return to it. When she refers to you in this song, she is referring to Wilhelm, not only because she is singing to him in this situation, but also because we know that she is in love with Wilhelm and wants to show him her homeland. This piece is strophic, meaning each verse has the same melody and harmony, in which one important figure is the tritone. For those who don't know, a tritone is an augmented fourth and divides the octave exactly in half. This is what it sounds like. This occurs in two places, but the most important and telling of the two examples occurs when Mignon sings Geliebte, Beschütze, and Vater, as she reverts to Wilhelm. This is what it sounds like. She exclaims, "There, there." However, in the last line, the tritone drags her and us out of this fantasy into reality, as its slower and more somber melody indicates that she recognizes that she is not back home, but still stuck in a foreign land. In this way, we can see how her mind and heart are still in Italy, even if her body is not, putting her in a liminal space. As I sing the entire piece, listen for when this tritone occurs. I would also ask you to listen to the piano at the very end of the piece, as I will talk about that later.
Thank you.
This next song, Nur wer die Sehnsucht kennt, is actually supposed to be sung as a duet between Mignon and the harper. However, this piece is usually only composed for Mignon. This is not a direct representation of the song from the novel, hence why some musicologists conclude that Schumann took the songs out of context. However, Schumann chooses to focus on liminality instead of the plot. If you listen to the end of Kennst du das Land, you noted that it is the opening line of the melody, but with a twist. This is how the vocal line of Kennst du das Land starts. And this is the piano part at the end. The end note seems to be reaching or stretching for something, possibly love or home. This is also important because the melody in Nur wer die Sehnsucht kennt starts like this. Schumann has created a melodic link between these songs, which is why it would make sense for them to be performed side by side. In fact, the songs are close together in the novel. However, that isn't what Schumann did. Instead, he put the Ballade des Hofers in between. This is another example of Schumann focusing on liminality rather than plot. The songs are clearly connected not only by the song, but also by the sense of longing, and another tritone leap which occurs in the middle of the piece. Yet Schumann deliberately separates them and puts another character's piece in between, which forces the audience to jump between the stories of the characters, creating a liminal space for them as well as for the characters themselves. As I sing this piece, listen to see what similarities or differences you can hear from Kennst du das Land, and how the space that I've placed between the songs with my lecture might affect your understanding of the song cycle. The next piece is a bit of an outlier from the other pieces in terms of its setting in the novel. Heiß mich nicht reden is recited expressively rather than being sung by Mignon, who talks about her vow not to tell her story to anyone if the Virgin Mary protects her. Schumann obviously picks up on this because he sets the beginning of the piece like a recitative. The instruction at the beginning of the piece is mit freiem leidenschaftlichen Vortrag, which translates to with free, passionate talk. It then transitions to a more lyrical section, which continues for more than half of the song before returning to another pseudo-recitative section at the end. This confusion of genre harkens back to the confusion of genre of the song cycle, though on a much smaller, more intricate level. In this way, the song moves through singing styles, thus making it another example of liminal space. As I sing this piece, listen for the points of transition between the styles. Schumann didn't reorder. It is the last song cycle. It's the last song of the book, and it is the last song of the cycle. Mignon is very ill, but is assigned to play an angel who gives gifts to children that Natalie, Wilhelm's love, is taking care of. She seems to recognize that she is dying and claims that her white dress and angelic appearance foreshadows her future incarnation as an angel in heaven after her death. The music does not have a clear tonal center for the entirety of the piece, thus connecting it to liminality. Moreover, the melody does not strongly situate itself within the rhythmic context of the accompaniment. This perhaps connects to the idea that Mignon is sick, and so is not in control, but also demonstrates how Mignon as a character exists in liminal space during this scene. Listen to the piece and think about how the song amplifies the sense of weakness or disconnect from the world. To summarize, we have observed how Schumann interpreted Goethe's novel and applied the liminal theme to his song cycle. First, I discussed Schumann's relationship to literature to prove how the conclusion drawn by Drachstein is improbable. Next, we examined Goethe's novel and how it is considered a Bildungsroman. We also defined the concepts of liminality as a function of Bildungsroman, which are found through the characters, plot, and organization of the novel. Thirdly, we went into detail about the construction of the opus, as well as the confusing genre, drawing connections to our discussion of liminality in Goethe's novel. Finally, we discussed how Schumann's construction of the characters' pieces reflects their characterization and link to liminality in Wilhelmmeister. Whether it is through Schumann's genre or setup of the song cycle and the opus in general, or specific connections to the setting itself, we have discovered that Schumann interpreted Goethe's novel despite superficial differences. We can discern how Schumann understood his relationship with literature from none other than Schumann himself, who wrote to his mother that, quote, "The poet sees better than other mortals. I do not see things as they are, but according to my own subjective impression, and this makes life easier and simpler," end quote. Schumann's own words lead to two different conclusions. The first suggests that Schumann is the poet, and therefore his work is more important than the original words. However, what the second implies, which I have proved with this lecture, is that by seeing things through his own subjectivity, Schumann actively interpreted the words of the poets, like Goethe, and worked his interpretation into his music. Thank you very much.